should do is we should evolve the Zen Open Hardware License so it covers the case of Brazil
and more the other. More or less like the Creative Commons thing.
Yeah, because this hardware travels, right?
Yeah.
So you cannot have a specific license for a country.
In Brazil, this is not a problem in Brazil because we have both in patent law and copyright law, we have a provision that says that if you expressly provide that is an international license, it can be valid by the Brazilian laws. So we can just put a...
Does that mean that I can impose the United States method of copyright on Brazil?
It's the reverse. If I have between two parties, two international parties, a license, and I say this license is international, so the party who is the licensee can use in other countries.
Okay.
Share a microphone. That's okay. You can handle. Oh, we have this one. Maybe someone can wear this.
I can wear that again.
Okay.
Okay.
And then.
Check 1, 2.
Javier will talk first, right, Javier, because you have a fight together.
Well, I have 1 hour, so I don't mind going second or third. It's just that after an hour I have to leave.
Okay, what do you guys prefer? I don't have it.
I just sent you the email so we can maybe take it from there.
Okay. So let's start this round table about legal aspects of open hardware. In the table, we have Pedro Ramos, who is a lawyer and master in from FGV. Javier Serrano, who is the section leader at CERN, and also one of the leaders of the Open Hardware Initiative at CERN. And Bruce Perens, who is known by the Open Source Initiative and of being the second leader of Debian. Okay, so I give the word to you.
Okay. So, first of all, I am an engineer and a physicist. I am not a legal expert like Bruce, and I am not a lawyer. So the role I play, I guess, is that I co-authored the CERN Open Hardware License, don't worry, in collaboration with a real lawyer. So that was part of a strategy at CERN to foster the sharing and the dissemination of hardware designs. And what makes the CERN Open Hardware special with respect to non-hardware licenses like the Creative Commons Share Alike license is that it takes into account the fact that the documentation, which in the license lingo means the design documents, the design files, is ultimately going to be used to build hardware. And there might be things that the designer, the licensor, might want to say about what happens when things are produced and distributed, okay? So the first advantage of the CERN Open Hardware License, and by the way, this is also an advantage of the Tapper Open Hardware License, is that it grants a patent license. So the licensee will not be sued by the licensor for patents relating, at least not in so far as their rights are necessary to exert the rights that the license grants. And then the other more controversial part of the CERN Open Hardware License, which I guess we will discuss here, has to do with the extent to which you can tell people what to do when they manufacture, okay? And here, the CERN Open Hardware License has a paragraph which tries to ensure that the recipients of hardware get access to the design files. And that this sharing goes on and on because the license is persistent. So if there are changes, there will also be distributed. The design files will also be distributed along with the products. So we did our best to get a text that would ensure that for people who want to perpetuate this sharing and this evolution inspired by the free software world and the copyleft licenses, we would like to get something going of the same type in the hardware world, because I personally believe that the success of free software is due to a large extent to the copyleft licenses, okay? So, that's my introduction.
Hi, I'm Bruce Perrins. You've mostly met me already, and I am a free software, open source, and open hardware guy who's been corrupted by law and seduced into working with lawyers on an almost daily basis by the totally astronomical money that you can make by doing this. And I take my ill-gotten gains and put them back into the creation of free software and open hardware. I don't feel bad about this because, as I said in my previous panel, lawyers are there to help us solve our disputes without having fistfights about them. There is a difference between this gentleman and myself, though, because in the English way of stating it, I am not admitted to the bar. That does not mean that I can't go get a drink. It means that I cannot be the person on the other side of the brass bar in the courtroom who practices law. And in the United States, the people who are admitted to the bar and thus licensed to grant legal opinions to their customers are members of the State Bar Association. And so what do I do if I'm not allowed to practice law and I'm not even allowed to give an opinion? Well, when you get my opinions, you should take them to your lawyer and see what your lawyer thinks. And that is indeed what my customers do. I work for, in general, the general counsel of a company. And I advise the general counsel, and then the general counsel gives their own opinion, which in general agrees with me. Now, we're going to talk about licenses in the context of Brazil, which is very interesting, but we must also transcend those to a global context, because a license which works in Brazil but does not work in the United States, India, or China is not all that useful. And thus, as you'll see, we have the clashes of different ways of talking about people's rights. So, Pedro, is that right?
Okay.
So, thank you very much, Pierre and Bruce, especially Bruce. Hello?
Oops. Yeah, another battery.
Hello. So, kind words about the legal profession. I like this comparison between legal profession and alcoholic beverages, because actually these are very similar fields of research. Most of my unfavorable legal opinions I produce when I'm sober, but when my clients want me to say, yes, you can, they pay me a drink. That happens all the time, but whenever. Well, my name is Pedro. I am a lawyer here in Brazil. I work in the last 8-9 years on the technology field. I am a researcher. I was a previous researcher at Stanford University on the field of internet architecture and regulation. And I also work with a lot of institutions in Brazil, such as FGV, Internet Lab, and the NGs from USP. And I know that you guys both know Javier and Bruce from the previous panel, so I prepared some 5-10 minutes presentation for you guys just to speak a little bit about who I am and talk a little bit about the intellectual foundations here in Brazil and how these intellectual property statutes, they relate with open source hardware. I think it's important for you guys to know the field before we enter into debate and hear your questions, of course. So first of all, I think I would start not with something related with law exactly, but related with culture, with something that I call consume, create culture, and consume only culture. This is not new. This is something that Lawrence Lessig from Creative Commons talked a lot about that. But it's important to know the difference when we talk about open source hardware and the law implications, legal implications of that. So I'd like to tell you a story. When the first phonographs appeared in the 19th century, people were kind of scared with these machines, and there were people that think that this would strangle creativity because people would lose their abilities to create songs, and folk songs that were passed through generations from families to families, communities to communities, they will not exist because people will stop to sing songs in the Porsches, and we would start only to buying LPs and listening to it. Of course, we did not, as a human being, lost our ability to compose a song or to create a music or play the guitar, but our committed folk culture, they don't exist anymore. We got used to worship the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Miles Davis, and nowadays, in terms of music, it's not unusual to say that we create less and we consume much more music. And it has been in all the fields of human creation. Nowadays, we buy things instead of create things. We buy foods, we buy chairs, we buy microphones, we buy software, we buy hardware all the time. So we are not used to create things that we will consume. We buy from someone else. And this is part from economics. It's a shift of culture. It's shift from a consume and create culture to a consume only culture. Of course, this is a top-down culture, a culture where creators widely distribute their creations to consumers. And law, of course, has a role in it. And intellectual property law was created to protect this kind of culture, but not from a consumer-create perspective, as I told you before, but especially the consumer-only perspective. So classic intellectual property law understands that we have a few, let's say, special gifted people who dedicate their lives to create something that will be consumed by the majority of people. So these people, these special gifted people, must have some legal protection, such as a copyright, such as a patent, such as author's right, the way we call copyright here in Brazil. But of course, this is changing a lot in the past few decades. Digital culture has somehow revived the ability of create because of user-generated content. Knowledge is now more and more available to everyone. People like me, who used to buy food from the supermarket, is now making my own food because of YouTube videos. And this is applied for all the fields of human knowledge, and that's a shift important to law too. So whenever we're talking about open source hardware in Brazil, we are essentially talking about contracts. Contracts that challenge the most common assumptions on IP law. We used to assume that if someone creates something, he needs to rush to the patent office and then protect its invention. What nowadays is happening is that community, free software community, free hardware community, is now creating contracts between these creators and the community that are inserted in to challenge these assumptions that are traditional to the patent system. And now I bring the good news. Brazilian law is not that bad for free software, open source hardware. First, we need to make clear that an open source hardware license is a contract. It's a contract between someone who or some people who is willing to create something with the community and want to make sure that these innovations will be publicly available to everyone. And then providing a consumer create ecosystem. So when we speak about a license, we do not talk about people distributing something without rules. We are saying that we do not want the traditional public sphere rules, let's say the patent system, but we are choosing a private party's rules, which is contracts. We have, like this, I was discussing with Javier before, we have template licenses that are now used by many institutions so as to promote and to foster creativity and foster the use of free software and open source hardware. And when we create a template for the community, we are saying to everyone that we want that the same principles that are applied in that license should be applied for everyone in that community. And the basic rule is simple, is a contractual rule. Keep it open. That's the rule. If we are creating something based on an innovation that is ruled under an open source hardware license, you can be forbidden to patent this or to close the open innovation circle. You must keep it open. And if in Brazil, talking about Brazilian law, if we want to break the circle of innovation, of free innovation here, likely people will fail because it will not fit in the patent requirements. So it is very difficult to patent something whenever this is openly available through an open source license, for an example. And of course, as I said before, and I'm insisting on that, when I say that a license is a contract, people who breach a contract are doing something that is condemned by law, and Brazilian law condemns someone who breaks contracts. So just join my brief presentation, what I think are the next steps for open source hardware from a legal perspective in Brazil. So first, as a lawyer, I believe that we should produce Brazilian template license, such as the guys have in Europe, the guys have in the United States, and we do not have this in Brazil. And open software and copyrights in general, we had the Creative Commons Initiative in Brazil a couple of years ago that tried to adapt license produced in the United States to the Brazilian law. And this is something that I really believe that if you want to foster a community of open source hardware in Brazil, especially from a legal perspective, this is something that we should aim, we should look for. And second discussion is about having maybe public databases. And it's very important to have public database to have whether these databases are controlled for government. I don't like this option, but they are crowdsourced by community. That is a good option. But these databases, they can present an historical account on what are the public available hardware and which can be good for innovation. And in the near future, we can even think about these databases being protected by blockchain systems, for example. So that was what I had to say. As I said before, I would talk like 5-10 minutes before, since you don't know me. Now I want to know you guys, and if you have any questions, please be free to ask for us.
Well, Pedro, I'll start. So you said that you were interested in drafting a template license for Brazil. I would encourage you to translate rather than invent. And the reason I would encourage that is that license compatibility and the combinatorial problem of having many licenses is a creator of difficulty for the open source developer. Because if I have a Mozilla license and GPL license, now if I combine pieces of software under those licenses, I have a combinatorial problem and I need legal advice. Now, take that and consider the fact that we have some 80 or 90 open source licenses. And to be pedantic, the number of combinations is factorial 90, a very large number.
Sure.
So for that reason, in the open source community, we discourage the creation of new licenses. And if you were to make one, for example, since we're a moral rights system here, copying from France an open source license that's already used there might be the very best option.
Sure. Yeah, I totally agree with you. The great problem of law is that law is national. We have a law for every country. So, of course, we can use something from France, but surely we can adapt a little bit for Brazilian legal perspective. The most common thing, the good example that I know, it's Creative Commons. Creative Commons, they used to have a general license that were applied for every country, and there were volunteers from each country that made few adaptations on each license, only to adapt to its local specificities. So this is something that I would encourage, to use a template that was, you know, maybe developed by SERS, for example, and try to make some only few adaptations based on Brazilian law.
Yes, I just wanted to compliment by discussing briefly about persistent and non-persistent licenses, or in the case of copyright or software-based licenses, it's copyleft or non-copyleft, copyleft or permissive. The problem of proliferation of licenses is especially important when your license is persistent. Okay, in the case of the CERN open hardware license and also the Tapper open hardware license, the license specifies that if the design documents are modified and published, that publication must happen under the same terms of the license, the same license. Now, imagine we have two persistent licenses, for example, the CERN OHL and the Brazilian OHL, and somebody grabs a piece of circuit schematics from a CERN OHL license design and a piece of schematics from the Brazilian open hardware license design. The combination, in principle, if both licenses have specified that the resulting the license of the modified derivative work has to be theirs, is impossible. And this is really a big problem. So not only, as Bruce said, in the general case of any type of license, it's a combinatorial problem and more thinking and more legal work to figure out if these things are compatible. But when in the particular case of persistent licenses, it can make the sharing, which is the very thing we're trying to foster, impossible. Okay. So I would be more of the opinion of drafting a license which covers as much as we can in terms of countries, and this is the effort we made in the CERN OHL. Now, it might be that we didn't achieve that, and that's why licenses have versions, so we are at version 1.2, and maybe if somebody identifies a need for a modification in the license terms so we can cover more countries, maybe it's time to initiate the process of another version. The perfect example for doing things which apply worldwide is the GPL. I mean, we always, in open source hardware, very, very often, we look at the case of free software because it has been fantastically successful, okay? And in no small measure, thanks to the power of the GPL and to the fact that it applies quite cleanly in most jurisdictions. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to say. By the way, I need to announce that I will have to be leaving you in half an hour. It's been great to be in Brazil, but I have to catch a plane.
We'll
so if you, yeah, you guys continue, I will kind of slowly, silently move out.
Do you want to comment?
No, I don't.
Okay, I have another question for you, if we don't have someone from the audience yet. Okay. So contracts are based on an exchange. They're not valid unless there is some sort of exchange between the parties, are they?
Not exactly in Brazil. this is a requirement from the U.S. law. In Brazil, this is not a special requirement for having a contract here in Brazil. For by the Brazilian law, the contract can only be an agreement between the parties. It does not have exactly to have an exchange between the parties. And let's say like that, if I want to donate you something, and I want to donate the cell phone to you, and you accept that, there's no exchange, but this is still a contract in Brazil. So Brazilian law, Brazilian contract law is quite different from the U.S. contract law.
What about consent?
The consent is mandatory here also.
Well, doesn't that break all of our open source licenses, though? Because one can receive open source software, and one does not necessarily consent to the license.
Let me put it in other terms. When I download something on the internet, let's say like the iTunes terms of use, okay? And I download that. Did you read that? The iTunes terms of use service?
Oh, perhaps you're talking about Tear Open licenses.
Yes, but the iTunes terms of service, the example I gave here, it's a contract for Brazilian law. So when I click, I agree in the iTunes terms of service, whatever I read or not, I'm consenting with that. And this is a contract by Brazilian law. So what I'm saying is that whenever someone downloads something which is available through a public license, through an open source license, someone is agreeing with it. So there is a consent, so there is a contract by the Brazilian law in the sense.
Okay, what if there is not an I agree button?
Yeah, and what would be the situation? I'm trying to understand.
Okay, so you get a CD of Red Hat Linux. Okay, and this may come with a magazine, it may be in a store, you may pick it up on the street. And it is an archive of source code. And for each of those source code packages, you can extract it, you can read it, and these things it is accepted that you can do. And then you go to modify it. You go to redistribute it. Now, these are rights that are restricted in copyright, so you cannot necessarily do them. And what we do in the States is we say, if you do modify, or if you do redistribute, we believe that that constitutes your agreement, since you would not have had the right to do those things without the license. Does that work in Brazil?
Not exactly. Let me get your example and try to reframe it for Brazilian reality. So if I have, and that once happened to me, if I download something and I do not click anywhere about whether I agree or not, and when I download, when I get this CD on the store, it has the source code and also have a TXT file there. And this TXT file is a open source license. It says, well, you can modify whatever you want, do whatever you want with this, as long as you keep it open for the next licensees that you get. This is a license. And this is like we call shrink wrap agreements here, like they have in the United States, and they are valid in Brazil.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I have this thing on. You can tell I really love the microphone. Okay, so what you're saying is that Brazil does have the concept of implied consent.
Exactly.
Okay, so implied consent is really fundamental for making open source licenses work. So let's go to a more complicated issue. Say that... this is the thing that Javier and I have been arguing about all day, if you've been listening, witnessing us furiously tapping on our keyboards. Say that you have a 3D printed object. Okay, so you have a program, and that program is copyright protected, and it is used to create the 3D printed object. But the 3D printed object itself can be taken and independently measured. And by doing something in technology called fitting a mesh to a 3D shape, I can derive the entire surface of the shape and potentially reproduce it without running the program, without any intermediate copying, and as far as I can tell, without infringing the program in any way. So can you think of something other than design patents that would protect that 3D shape using copyright?
Yes, absolutely. In Brazil, first of all, for the guys in the audience, it's important to let you guys know, copyright in Portuguese, direito da cópia, is not the same as direito do autor, author's right. We have two different schools of thinking regarding law studies about that, and Brazilian has adopted the law. The author's rights system, which is the same they use in France and Portugal, most of East Central Europe, and United States, England, and other countries adopt copyright, direito da cópia. And these are some differences in terms of legal provisions, let's say like that. So answering Bruce's question, what we have in Brazil is that our author's right, our copyright, it's not excludent from patent system. So you can have both things. I can protect something with the design of that. I can protect the design of something. And if this design can be put into an industrial production, I can also protect this design through what we call the industrial design, which are different things here. Industrial design is patent rights, and design itself, it's author's rights. So you can have both protections in Brazil, and this is not a problem here.
What are the terms of each?
Well, in patent, 20 years, and author's right, 50 years. 50 years from the death of the author.
Okay, 50 years after the death of the author.
Yeah, in some cases it can be 70.
Is Brazil signatory to the Berne Copyright Convention?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so... So the Berne Copyright Convention is what gets together every 20 years, and it increases that number. Yeah. And as I explained...
It's the Disney factor.
Yeah, that's right. That's how I explained it yesterday. Mickey Mouse won't go in the public domain. Okay. You want to say something, Javier, before you leave?
Yeah. Does anybody want to intervene, ask questions, make comments? Okay. I think this, I just want to mention regarding, this is the crux of the discussion, is to which extent the production of hardware and the distribution is covered by these licenses. This is, in my opinion, important, and that's why we try to achieve something in that regard in the CERN OHL, because we imagine a world where people would design massive amounts of open source hardware, make that hardware available, and then the recipients of those designs could modify them, improve them, and the rest of the world would benefit from those improvements. But also the recipients of the hardware itself, it would be very nice if they also had access to the design files and they could change whatever piece of hardware they received in terms of design, manufacture, and share again. And this virtuous circle of sharing, which reminds very much of what's happened with the copyleft licenses in the free software world, we believe that's a good thing. Now, the particular paragraph in the CERN OHL where this is described is 4.1, version 1.2 of the CERN Open Hardware License, which says that the licensee may manufacture or distribute products, always provided that where such manufacture or distribution requires a license under this license, the licensee provides to each recipient of such products an easy means of accessing a copy of the documentation or modified documentation. Now, notice one thing. This is a license which was drafted with the aim of being applicable worldwide, and this is very important because we are in a very connected world, and we don't want people, if you write a license, you want people to go by the terms of the license. You know, moving to another country should not make it very easy to just forego whatever, bypass whatever terms of license. Now, notice one important thing that happens basically in all licenses which have a name of the aim of being universal, we don't talk about the rights that might be infringed. We are discussing a lot about copyright here, but there is design rights in the UK. There is author rights in France, in Brazil. So there is no mention, okay? It just says where such manufacturer or distribution requires a license. There may or may not be that requirement in a given place. It's difficult to say, not only today, but how rights will evolve in the future, okay? So this is what we believe was our best try at trying to achieve that effect, that copyleft effect, so to speak, okay? It's not copyleft, it's hardware, but it's that persistence, okay? This is what we're trying to achieve. We believe that's the best we could do by reading literature, discussing with experts. The CERN Open Hardware License itself is an open source project. It has a mailing list where the best scholars and the best experts that I know were during the discussion of the version 1.2 of the license, of the drafting of the license. And it is aimed, it is supposed to be evolving as we learn more about how to foster these behaviors of sharing.
So the Tapper license is the same. The Tapper license came before the CERN license and I believe was used as input, and our attorney, you acknowledged, also gave you quite a lot of advice. And actually, besides contributing to Tapper, I got you to remove something from CERN, so I can claim that one too. And so this is very important because there may be these rights that you don't really think of that you have, that you are licensing to people. Like, you know, perhaps you might bring out, you might take out a patent. You might still have time to do so. You might not have disclosed in a way that prevents it. Perhaps you will have a mask programming right, a really strange thing which exists in the United States that might apply to the shape of a printed circuit board trace, for example. And at the same time, this is, in my mind, a little of a problem, because in the case of both these licenses, you are potentially granting people a license to rights which you don't actually have. For many of these projects, you will not have anything patentable, or you will not be taking out a patent. You will not have any mask programming rights. You will not have a design patent. And in that case, these licenses are really sort of giving you something hollow. And at least in the States, again, where we have this concept of a contract has to have an exchange, in my mind, this could potentially invalidate the contract, perhaps not in Brazil.
Do you guys have any questions? Please don't be shy.
It's a hard topic for an audience.
If someone wants to, you know, don't be shy again, but if someone wants to go a step back and ask something about intellectual property itself or copyright or something that you got confused hearing, we're talking here because we're talking about, although I am the only one who had the bar here, we're talking about specialists here, and they know much more than me do know about this topic. So I will incentivize you guys to ask questions too. If you want to ask in Portuguese, you can ask in Portuguese too, then we translate to the audience, no problem.
So I got interest about this difference between the how authors' right works in Brazil and France and Portugal, and the copyright. That's mainly what we hear here when we study about this. We study on the United States perspective. So I think you could clarify, please.
Basically, the idea is that in the United States, let's say the gravitational force, the center of the law of the intellectual property concern whenever you call this is the copy of the product. So we're talking about protecting the product, protecting the music, and protecting the book, protecting the software, etc. In Brazil and France, we have the author's right doctrine, and it says that we not only have to protect the thing itself, but we have to protect the author itself. So when we go to author's right, we have something that we call moral rights, which are not that common in the United States, but mostly in case law, they apply something related with moral rights. But in Brazil, it's something statutory, that say it is written in the law. So that's one of the examples. I can spend that all the afternoon and evening with you guys talking about the difference. But one difference is very keen, it's very famous, which is the ghostwriters. Have you ever heard about ghostwriters in the United States? The ones who, let's say, Donald Trump makes his own autobiography, but he didn't write anything. There's someone wrote for him. And the same would apply to any other celebrity that do autobiographies there, but they don't write anything. They contract, they hire someone to do that. They hire people that we call ghostwriters. They are paid for that. So in Brazil, because of moral rights, ghostwriters are prohibited by law. Even if I accept to be a ghostwriter, I cannot do that because of moral rights. The same happens in France, the same happens in Portugal. So that's why it's very common in Brazil to have two authors in a book. Let's say like Daniela Sicarelli, a famous model in Brazil, is writing her own autobiography. And like say Daniela Sicarelli, with the help of Pedro Ramos. Basically, Pedro Ramos wrote everything, but she's like the co-author. This happens in Brazil all the time and does not happen in the United States. So this is one of the differences. We can spend all the afternoon and weekend saying about that. But basically, the main difference is that in the United States, they are very worried about protecting the thing. And in France and Brazil, we are very worried in protecting the author.
Is there any, somebody in the back?
Well, and how do you think that is applied to open source hardware? I mean, this difference, what makes it different? In Portuguese, I got lost. Na em português, então, para como que afeta? Qual que é a diferença? Entende? Porque o que isso prejudica? Se é melhor ou pior?
As diferenças.
How does the difference between authorized and copyright affect the customers?
Thanks for your question. It does not affect much in case of open source hardware because it will only affect in two things. The first one is that we have here in Brazil one statute that prohibits someone who's saying that I am not the author of something. And when you say we have maybe in some kinds of free software a list of many creators of the software, like A, B, C, D, and then 100 creators or co-creators of this software, it comes because of author's rights, because you have to establish who is the author, whenever the author wants to be published. And the other thing that would apply very little in the case of open source software, but apply open source hardware, it is one thing that we call, let's say, difficult to translate in English, but I will call the moral right of the author to prohibit whenever someone is using the software or the hardware, and this use is affecting its own public image. Let's say like that. Well, it's very hard to apply that to software and to hardware. So I'm gonna say another example. Let's say like I do.
How is it related to trademark?
Yeah, trademark is not applied to trademark. This is only for copyright.
Okay.
This one. My example will be this one. Imagine that I create a song, an open source song, and it's song, it's a children's song, and I want to freely make available this song for any father or mother to co-create this song for their children. And there is someone who puts in the YouTube this song, and he tried to co-create, to remix the song with dirty words, very dirty words. And of course, it affected the original aim, the original goal of me licensing that. I wanted to license this to parents for their children, and someone is making a bad use of this. In this case, I would have the right to prohibit the remix of the song. It's like a moral right to stop someone to doing something that is harmful for my image and for the intention of the song.
So, as I said, it's very difficult to apply this to software and hardware.
That's a good thing.
was the relation you made there between what's the domain of the patents over there and what's the domain of the license in the case of the hardware? So as I understood in the beginning, the license would be like a contract alternative to the patents, but I don't know how it applies. Actually, you could do that, and actually, what would be the difference of this, of how this applies? Is applied to the design itself or to the hardware as a whole? Because there was this point has been discussed a lot the last 3 days. So I would like to understand this in the Brazilian perspective.
When you said protect the author and protect the creation, could you give us examples of protect against what? I think with this kind of examples would be better to understand the difference between them.
I think what he has to reflect again.
So first, I will separate your answer in two different parts. First one is the last one that you talk about, the license. So it's important to understand that from the Brazilian law perspective, you can license a patent or you can license a copyright, an author's right. There's no problem about this. So you can license a software, you can license a design, and you can license a patent, you can license an industrial design. There's no problem. It's a contract and you can apply for both things. Even if we're talking about patent system or whether we're talking about author's right and copyright system, okay? So license can apply for both cases. And this first question about the difference, what is a license, what is a design protected by the copyright, the author's right, or what is a design protected by the patent system? The difference in Brazil is the state of art of both things. When I dropped a design here in my computer, and it's a drawing, okay? It's only a drawing. And this drawing is protected by copyright, by author's right. So this is protectable. I don't need to register it, and it's still protectable in any case worldwide, okay? So if I want to apply this for an industrial intent, so I want to make use of it from an industrial perspective, I want to put in a fabric and start working on that, this can be protected by what we call industrial design, which is a patent system. So it's one is complementary to each another, okay? In the first beginning, I have only a drawing, it's copyrightable, let's say like that. And after that, I have an industrial design, which can be patent, if I want to, of course.
I agree that you can do both things at the same time. One thing does not exclude the other, because I think your question was whether designs are more in the patent domain or in the license domain. I don't think one excludes.
And in particular, the CERN Open Hardware License and the Tapper Open Hardware License both acknowledge the fact that the licensor might hold patents on the design, the original designer might hold a patent, and it's because of that that the license contains a clause which says that the licensor grants a license for any patent that it holds, such that all the rights that this license gives you you can exercise those rights, okay, that the licensor will not sue you because you have infringed that patent. So the very fact that this text is in the licenses is an acknowledgement that, you know, you can have licenses and patents together.
The difference really is ease of use for you. I think 210 countries are signatory to the Berne Convention, which says, among other things, that you have a copyright right as soon as something is fixated. And what that means is, as soon as you set pen to paper or any permanent medium, so putting it on a disk storage qualifies. You've copyright the moment that happens, and you do not have to write copyright C in a date the way we did before the 80s. Thank you, Javier. See you later. And thus, copyright is just so much easier for us than patents, which cost tremendously much to execute.
About your question, just to make sure that I understood well, you want to know examples about infringement, whether someone is breaching the copyright.
There is a law to protect the authors and there is a law to protect the creation and the product.
It's not, there are no different laws, okay? It's the one that is applied in the US, the US law, the copyright law there, and the Brazilian copyright law that we in Brazil call the author's law. So the difference are examples like the one I said, the ghostwriter. In United States you can have ghostwriters, and in Brazil you cannot have ghostwriters, and this is something that is related with the difference between those systems, okay? But in both cases you can protect something, and the idea is the same. You have to protect something, and you need to protect something. We're talking about details on these exceptions, let's say like that they are more permissive in the US than we are here in Brazil and France, especially.
Your question was about protect against what? Give examples of what you.
Okay, repeating the question. The question is protect against what? Could you give us some examples about what could be done or could not, or you can copy but you can modify, but you can't publish if you don't modify it enough or something like that?
It always depends on the terms of the license, the contract between the parties who say what can you do with this copyright, this product. Let's say like that, if you buy some proprietary software like Windows, you can buy here the Office, and there is a license there that says that you cannot copy this and give to someone else. You cannot duplicate that. You cannot install many times this software. This is one of the terms of the license, and if you do this, you can be prosecuted by that. This is one example. It always depends on the terms of the license. If I say that you can only use my license, pay me a fee, and use it without paying me a fee, you are infringing the license. So it will depend on the terms of the license. When we're talking about an open hardware license, open source hardware license, I'm not saying that it's a permissionless software. I'm not saying that I can use that for the heck I want. I'm saying that you can use that if you follow these rules, and I have to write down these rules. And also, as I said before, it's a contract. It also depends on what I'm saying in the contract.
And this example was about protect the product. And could you give us examples about protect the author?
Like the one before, let's say like, I say that you can use the software, okay? You can use the software the way you want to, you can remix that, you can duplicate that, but you cannot use the software for unlawful ways, like, let's say, like, create a children pornography website. This is one condition that I can put, because it's related with me as an author. I don't want to see people using my software or my hardware for unlawful ways.
You've got the only working one.
Vou fazer a pergunta em português mesmo, então.
ficou meio difuso para mim, assim, eu acho que alguns dos meus colegas também, é uma coisa que a gente tem conversado muito, assim, sobre justamente os termos e condições necessários para que a gente possa desenvolver um hardware aberto e livre, ou seja, que as pessoas tenham as liberdades, mas ao mesmo tempo a gente consiga garantir de que ninguém vai pegar e fechar isso. Ou seja, se a gente não fizer uma patente e deixar aberto, isso vai ficar, qualquer um pode pegar e fechar e já era. Mas aí se a gente fizer uma patente e tem como manter ela aberta, assim, tipo, ah, tu pode fazer a minha patente, o que eu fiz, igual, contanto que tu siga essas regras aqui de não, sabe? Nesse sentido, assim.
Do you mind if I speak for them in
Portuguese? I'm sorry?
Do you mind if I speak for them in Portuguese this time?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Pessoal, vou explicar em português para ficar bem clara essa questão aqui. Desculpa, qual é o seu nome? Christian, fica bem clara aqui essa divisão, tá? Eu acho que isso vai ficar bastante evidente para todo mundo, essa questão de como nós aplicaríamos no Brasil o open source hardware, tá? Uma licença open source no Brasil, ela dificilmente seria patenteável. Eu dificilmente conseguiria levar para patente isso. A lei de patentes aqui no Brasil coloca como requisito para uma patente que ela seja uma novidade e que esteja no que nós chamamos aqui de estado da técnica. Ou seja, as particularidades daquele produto, daquela invenção, não podem ser publicamente disponíveis antes da entrada no Instituto Nacional da Propriedade Intelectual, do INPI. Ou seja, quando eu crio um hardware livre, eu não estou criando algo que vai ser patenteável. Porque na hora que eu fizer o requerimento para patente, eu não vou conseguir, porque eu não tenho os requerimentos necessários pela lei. Então, o que vai acontecer na prática? Tá? Na prática, a gente vai ter a seguinte situação. Um hardware livre, em que é disponibilizado de forma livre e aberta para todos, ele pode ser protegido por meio de uma licença que vai utilizar como principais bases dessa licença direito do autor, e não direito de patente, porque não vai ser patenteável. A melhor forma de vocês fazerem com que aquele hardware livre continue aberto e livre é da mesma forma que se faz com o software livre, por meio de licenças abertas. E a proteção que vocês têm de que ninguém vai pegar aquilo lá e fechar, como você disse, e levar para o INPI, são duas. Primeiro, a própria lei de patentes e, segundo, a licença em si enquanto um contrato. Tá? São essas duas proteções maiores que vocês têm.
So I think maybe it would be important to translate it to Bruce, because I think it was
in short.
And also, if you could complement, you said that it's important to publicize it, and I don't know how formal it should be, this publicization. Like how should you make it public, your design project?
So I was saying to them, just to be very clear to them, that in Brazil, open hardware is possible. And the two main protections of open hardware here in Brazil would be the patent law, because you cannot, if something is open, it would not be acceptable for the Brazilian patent office to be a patent.
This is something. You've disclosed it.
You disclosed that, you got it.
And thus you cannot claim it as a protected.
Exactly. Advantage. And the second one would be the license itself, when you would protect the open source hardware in a very similar way that you do with open software license, that is, with copyright, stuff like that. So
let's talk about something else. In the United States, I published a debugging program called Electric Fence. And after I published this program, AT&T went to patent some of the principles in the program and then discovered during pursuit of the patent that I had published this on the internet. And at that time, AT&T voluntarily removed one of the claims from the patent. So that is the first that I know of example of open source software being prior art, which was actually used to kill part of a patent. Is open source hardware and open source software a good way to provide prior art in Brazil?
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah. We can prevent patents from happening, potentially.
Exactly. Bruce said one word that is very important for you guys for the translation. He said prior art. When I talked before in Portuguese for you guys, prior art is the same in Portuguese, estado da técnica.
where I said before. This is translation. So prior art is one way. If you disclose the prior art, yeah, that's rocks, baby. If you disclose the prior art of something, you kill the patent. And it's very hard to have a patent if you disclosed before the prior art of something. So this is a very good point, Bruce. Just for a curiosity here, I'm very curious about, is there anyone from humanities course here, or everyone is from computation, engineer, everything else?
I'm a communication arts major.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
I'm a filmmaker.
So everybody is engineers, right? Engineers or computation. Just raise your hands if some of you guys had some law subject during graduation. Only two of you guys.
Oh, I have a rant about this.
Me too.
Okay, and my rant is, if you are software engineers, the job of a software engineer today is to take the intellectual property of other people and combine it, producing a derivative work. And you have not at all been prepared in college engineering courses to do what you actually do on a day-to-day basis at work.
Exactly. That's very strange, because you guys will be graduated soon and you don't know nothing about law. That's good. That's something that you should pursue. Yeah.
They're working and they know nothing about law, and it is the exact same in the United States, and I'm very glad at it of it, because I get paid to explain law to engineers.
This is something curious. I was teaching a lesson last month in an engineer school here, and it was final semester, something like that, and people, they were the first one who were talking with them during the whole engineering school about what is a patent. So it's important for you guys to have this notion. So answering your final question, which I don't remember anymore. Okay. You don't have any formalities in Brazil when it comes to the estado da técnica or copyrights. You can publicize in a website or any kind of database. You don't have to go to any specific place to make a registration. It would be valid.
What about the concept of work for hire in the Brazilian context?
We don't have work for hire here in Brazil. We only have, in the United States, we have the work made for hire as an assumption, as a presumption, when you're working for a company here in Brazil, in the United States. In Brazil, because of authors law, you don't have this as a presumption, as an assumption. You need to have a contractual provision about that to be valid.
So when you accept employment in Brazil, you sign a contract that says,
exactly,
you will dedicate your patents and copyrights to your employer.
Exactly.
Okay.
So this is different from the US too.
Just a point.
No, you can assign all the rights to the company if you want to, but it must be written in Brazil. This is something very different to the United States. In the United States, when he talks about work made for hire, they say about a presumption, uma presunção, if you work for a company, you are given all the rights, all the creations, all the things that you invented in the company to the company. This is a presunção in the United States. In Brazil, that does not happen. It must be a written assignment of rights, a contract between the employee and the employer. And if you work as a software engineer, if you work as an artist, in an advertising agency, whatever, if you work in places where you really work with creating things, it's normal, it's usual for companies to make you sign an assignment agreement whenever you enter in the company. This is totally common. And this assignment agreement will have the rules of the game. If there's a full assignment, it's a limited assignment, and everything else, the rules of the game will be written in this agreement.
So that's the best moment for you to negotiate.
Exactly. And many companies, it's not that common, but in many companies, there are different compensations for employees who do not assign the work to the companies and employees who assign the work to a company.
So there can be a full transmission of the work done. So who needs to die so I can have it in public domain?
To trigger the copyright term,
50
years. Yeah, but we talk about death of the author.
Okay.
50 years. But what about the company?
Oh. We're talking about
when
the
does
company.
When does a company die? How does it trigger the copyright?
It's very difficult. But in Brazil, this, in case of software, which is the most common thing here nowadays, it's 50 years from the creation. It doesn't matter if it was created by the company or by a natural person. It's 50 years from the creation. It doesn't matter the death of the company or the person.
What about dedication to the public domain in Brazil?
You say if someone wants to create something and in the moment of creation it wants to dedicate to the public domain, that's your question. So the question, it's possible here, okay, no problem with that. You can create something in Brazil and say to everyone that I'm creating that to everyone, to everybody without limitation. But something that is different from the United States, again, because of the difference between copyright and author's rights, when someone creates something to the public domain in the United States, it's a full assignment, a full transmission of the rights to the general public. In Brazil, moral rights are not assignable. You cannot transmit your moral rights. So if I transmit my moral rights and I regret 10 years later, no problem, it's okay. Because you never transmit your moral rights in Brazil. We have a good example. We are out of time. How are we now?
Okay,
I will tell you guys a story, and Bruce, I think he will be entertained about that. Everybody knows Xuxa here. Xuxa was a famous presenter in television here in Brazil, and she used to present programs for children here in Brazil. And she was very famous. She was called Queen of the Children here in Brazil during the 80s and the 90s. But before that, she had a very troubled past with soft porn movies here in Brazil, before working with children on the television. And so she used to be an actress in one of these soft porn movies, and she assigned all the rights, all the image rights, author rights, everything else, to the company, to the studio who was distributing this film. This was in the late 70s, beginning of the 80s. So 10 years after that, she was the queen of the children. She was the most famous presenter for children in Brazil. And when internet started to boom in the late 90s in Brazil, the videos of her started to showing up in the internet. So she said, well, although I signed my rights, I have the moral rights to ask someone to take off all my work, all my videos, because it is against my reputation, against my moral in Brazil. So this is a very famous case of moral rights in Brazil, and she won this case in Brazil because of that. Although she assigned that 25 years ago, she had the right to regret that and take off from circulation all the videos of the soft porn movies.
Okay, what about dual licensing? So dual licensing, what?
Pardon? Dual license?
Dual licensing. Okay. So dual licensing is a scheme where we license something as open source, in general under a restrictive open source license. I generally use Afaro GPL3, which is the most restrictive open source license. And then separately, we grant a commercial license to people who pay us. And this is a way for us to have our cake and eat it, to have a revenue stream from people who don't want to share their innovation and to exchange source code with people who do want to share their innovation. Now, the complexity of this comes in because to dual license effectively, I need either to own the entire copyright, and I can't because I can't have ghostwriters, Or I need to have the right to relicense all of the software. So what would I do to implement dual licensing in Brazil?
It's totally possible in Brazil. Me, myself, we did in the firm a couple of years ago for a company. It's contractual. You can have this, but you have to put very clearly in the contract what are the terms and conditions, including the sublicense that will happen after that.
So I'd have a developer agreement.
Yeah, you need to have on one side a developer agreement, on the other side a license agreement.
Mm-hmm. How are we doing?
Regarding the board rights, isn't that related also to
this? Regarding the dedication to public domain, because of the moral rights that we cannot give up, does that mean that it's forbidden to have anonymity?
To have a what?
Anonymity. Use pseudonyms.
Yeah, in Brazil, anonymity is different from the US too, but it's not a matter of intellectual property. It's a matter of the Brazilian constitution. It's very different from the US too. In the US, you have the right to be anonymous if you want to. In Brazil, you do not have this right. This is from our federal constitution of 88. So you don't have the right to be anonymous in Brazil. So whether you want to write something or develop something, you must have your authorship assigned there. You cannot be anonymous in Brazil.
So can I be pseudonymous instead?
I didn't understand.
A pseudonym.
Yes, you can do that, but I will give you an example to be very clear. In the 70s, it was common for journalists to have pseudonyms in media, in journals and magazines, etc. But if someone sues the magazine for something that the pseudonymous said or wrote,
libel.
Yeah, that was a question. The magazine would have to choose, or she would have to reveal who is the pseudonym, or she would assume all the liability. That's what's happened in Brazil. If you publish something with a pseudonym or with anonymity, like they do all the time in columns in the newspaper, like editoriais here in Brazil, you have to face if you want to assume the liability as a company, or you will disclose who is the pseudonym.
So it's the publisher is liable unless they want to reveal the author.
Perfect.
Well, to finish what John was saying before, in US, how long lasts the software copyright?
In the US?
I didn't get the question.
How's the term of software rights in the US? Is the term of copyright?
Well, we have software copyright in the U.S., and we also have software patents. And software patents have recently been set back in the court, but have not been totally put out of existence. So these are for systems and methods which are implemented in software rather than the literal words of the software. What about software patents in Brazil?
Not allowed.
Okay, good for Brazil.
Yeah.
He wanted to just finish what I was asking, and I meant to ask, in the U.S., if I dedicate my work to a company, if it's the company's work, how does copyright apply? How much time copyright lasts?
Well, in the United States, it is you, the author, not the corporation, at least so far. I live in horror that it will become the corporation, because corporations are immortal. So right now, it is your life plus 95 years, if I have that correct. I think I do. And what? I'm not sure. But it's a very long time. And if it turned out that the corporation was viewed as the author instead of an individual, it would actually be infinity plus some number of years, which we very definitely don't want, but I can see the film companies going for that.
Okay, then. I will take a broader scope now. Laws are somewhat different. And
they are different somewhat from
the background. So
I will start again. Laws are somewhat different everywhere. So how products copyrights out of how are they interpreted? They are like objective and de facto, or they are subjective and the jury. What I'm asking is, how can one delineate the legal boundaries, and how can open software and hardware fare in this field?
Did you understand the question?
I'll try to rephrase your question if I rightly understood. You set a very broad question about how open software, you were talking about software itself, would fit in the legal system in Brazil. It would fit like a very objective thing, like a right itself, or it would fit as a metaphor of the law, stuff like that. That was your question? Quer falar em português?
Quer fazer uma patente, quer fazer um design de produto, até onde vai a barreira, pode dizer que esse produto foi copiado ou não. Então, vai ser, além de ser específico.
Ok. So, the question... His question was, what are the, how courts evaluate if something is being copied or not being copied here in Brazil? And this is a very objective question in Brazil, because we have, at least in three different statutes, three different leis here in Brazil, we have the requirements to say if something is infringing other thing or not. So this is very clear in Brazil. We have some requirements based on the law, software law, author's right law, and patent law. And these are exhaustive situations. And you, when you see the law, you will know if it's infringing or not. It's quite difficult. I have to go back a little bit and start to talk about the origin of the difference between United States law and Brazilian law. When we talk about US law, we're talking about a legal system that gives a lot of power to courts, to judges. That happens in the United States. So
they're precedential.
Yeah. So in the United States, they have the precedence, they have the case law, and what in Brazil we call jurisprudência. Case law in the United States, it's very important. It's the opinion of the judges that are passing through time that can vary. If you are in Minnesota, if you are in Cambridge, if you are in New York, because the judges in that court can have different opinions for the judge on other court. It's tricky. It's, for us Brazilians are like crazy, the legal system there, but have different original, different histories. In Brazil, we have a history based on Roman law. Romans were very keen to statutes. They wanted to draft everything on the table. So that's what happens in Brazil. Our judges, they do not have so much power than the United States, because we have a lot of different laws. Let's say in the United States, the Constitution of the United States, they have like 27, 28 paragraphs, something like that. And in Brazil, we have 300 paragraphs. And that's not Brazil's better or worse than the United States. It's different legal systems, totally different. We cannot compare each other.
Well, we have 37 paragraphs and an entire library full of case law.
Exactly.
So what happens in the United States is we have circuits, which are a number of states. Silicon Valley is the Ninth Circuit, and so
circuito your case, comarcas, tá?
Okay, and it's called a circuit because the judge used to ride on a horse in a circle between towns, and so your case will be heard in a particular circuit and will have precedent within that circuit. Now, if you don't like what the judge did, you have the right to appeal, and you can appeal to a higher court, and if you lose your appeal, you can appeal to the Supreme Court. So if you are in the jurisdiction of the higher court, now that case is precedential to you, and everyone in the states is in the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. So if they make a decision, it applies to everyone. I don't even know if you have the right of appeal.
We have right of appeal.
Okay.
Okay. So I believe it's important for the open source hardware movement to know in Brazil, to know what are those specifications to prove that something was copied, so we can know exactly how well documented our hardware needs to be, so we can prove that someone copied, and then we prove that it was ours or something.
Well, what precaution should they take in general?
In Brazil, the specifications of the law are very protective, okay? So if you draft something as detailed as possible, it will be very hard to copy something and not be prosecuted, not be infringing the rights. So if you detail a lot, that's good for you. If you write something very broad, very evasive, that can be hard for you because a judge can say that you are not writing hardware, you're not writing software, you're writing ideas. So ideas are not, is another realm, it's not a realm of protection. So if you write as detailed as possible, the more detailed, the better.
What about database copyrights in that case?
We have database copyrights in
Brazil. So a collection of fact is copyrightable,
yes,
once you put it in a database, regardless of its organization?
Yes, a database is protected in Brazil, but you must have the means to prove that this is an organized database. It's not only a full amount of things there.
So is the telephone book copyrighted here?
That's a good discussion. There was a very common discussion in the 80s and the 90s. We have different decisions in Brazil from different judges. And when they were starting to pacify this decision in Brazilian Supreme Court, the yellow pages here, they were dead here. But in general, yellow pages are not considered to be copyrights in Brazil.
Okay, so another case that affected the Linux community was there was a book which was an ephemerides, and it essentially described how time was organized all around the world. And we found in the United States, and that book was used as a source for the time zone software in the Linux system. And we found in the United States that that was a collection of fact and not copyrightable. What would happen in Brazil?
I think the same. It would be a collection of facts, not a copyright itself.
Okay.
Okay, so I think we reached the end of the roundtable. I'd like to thank Pedro Ramos and Bruce Perens.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.